A lot of people tell me every time that I look kind of like Rick Ross with this beard.
I don't get it.
I really don't get it. What is souse? So, whenever I mention souse to practically anyone, I usually hear three questions. And the first one I usually hear from people that don't live in Barbados, and that's usually, what on earth is souse? The second one is usually, where can I get the best souse in Barbados? And the last one, well, that one is usually, are you Rick Ross? Because of the beard, and I don't really get it because I don't really look anything like him. Okay, maybe I look a little bit like him, but I don't really see it.
So to get a better grasp of what souse is, I turned to noted historian Trevor Marshall to see if he could shed any light on where it all began.
Lights, wait, camera, wait, action.
Go ahead. Action, sir.
Right on. The history of pudding and souse, and particularly souse in the Caribbean, is not complex, nor is it simple. We seem to have two matrices. One matrix, some persons have argued, would be Scotland and the Scottish practice of developing haggis, which is cleaning out the sheep's stomach and filling it with all kinds of bits and pieces of food, odds and ends, a cobbler pot. And therefore, or thereafter, boiling it and producing it with a lot of condiments, salt, black pepper, parsley, basil, etc., and making it into a very tasty stew. There are those who would argue to the ground that our black pudding and souse comes from the practice of haggis, which the Scottish indentured servants, so-called white slaves, would have brought to Barbados and other Caribbean territories and would have taught the African enslaved. What about pickling? Pickling, or sousing, is exactly this. You take meat and you put it down overnight. You garnish it with all kinds of condiments, lime, salt, and black pepper, of course. And this seems to be universal as a way of preserving meat.
So as a subculture, souse is just something that people kind of don't talk about or embrace fully. And it's kind of strange because everyone's into it and we're all crazy about it. So why don't we just talk about it in the manner that it really should be talked about? But that's strange, because it seems as though it's something that we just clamor for on a weekend. As a matter of fact, why do we tend to just look for souse on a weekend?
Why do we have that tradition of pudding and souse being served almost exclusively and not particularly on weekends? It is a matter of the process of preparation. It was not every day that you killed a pig. And in the old days, you killed a pig on Thursday. So that the pig would be ready, people would be selling meat which had been engaged, that is reserved, on a Friday and Saturday. And from the time that pig was killed on Thursday night, and some of us were kept away with the squealing and the pig sticking, and you boiled the pig and got off all of the outer hair, and you started to cut up that. The entrails were given to that person, and that's Thursday night. That person is now running a race with time to get it ready for Saturday. Why Saturday? Because cricket was on Saturday. And more to the point, horse racing was Saturday. And when you had horse racing on the garrison, and there are pictures to show this, you had rolls of serpentine black pudding. and alongside it, sauce. So every self-respecting sauce provider tried to get to the garrison to sell on Saturdays, to sell pickled food. Then to certain parts in Bridgetown, which were really the hangouts of persons who were adventurous. The red light district of Nelson Street, you had to have pickled and black pudding by Friday night for the persons coming down from the country district who came to really to acquaint themselves with the flesh pots, the flesh pots of Nelson Street. So if you didn't get human flesh, you ate pig flesh, pickled, hot.
So I still want to know more about sauce and pickle culture in Barbados. I know what you're thinking. I still kind of look like Rick Ross, but that's besides the point. You're thinking as well that maybe I should get some help from some people, and that's exactly what I did. I teamed up with three of my friends. One, Trevor, aka the sauce father. Two would be Ramon, aka the sauce snob, and my friend Stephen Brathwaite, aka just Brath. They gave me their perspectives on sauce.
First off, we head to Oystens Christ Church, which is located within the south of Barbados and is mostly known for its fish, but here is where you can find Fred's Bar, which itself is known for having some of the best pudding and sauce in the country. And this is where we were able to meet up with the sauce father himself, Trevor Wood. Now, Trevor runs a small group on Facebook dedicated towards sauce, and by small, I mean it has over 1,000 members. And in that group, you're able to find out where you can get sauce on any day of the week. This is because they have a sauce directory with a listing of quite a few places that have sauce.
I'm fascinated with Bajan things on a whole, right? And for me, sauce is the de facto dish of Barbados. It's the national dish, right? Nobody goes looking for cuckoo and fly fish to lime on a Saturday, right? And one of the things that got me interested in starting the group was a Saturday, I thought, well, I'd like some sauce, but it would have to be sold out at this time. But it occurred to me, what is it that no matter who sells sauce, is always sold out? It can't only be me that likes sauce, right? And then from that, that's where I started the group. And it attracted other people, and from there we decided to go around and sample sauce, make recommendations, right?
What is your criteria for good sauce? Because for me, sauce is a very subjective thing. Right. I've gone places where people have said the sauce is great, and when I've had it, I was like, no. It had either too much pepper, which drowned out the taste of the flavors right. of the sauce and the black pudding and stuff. So what for you is the criteria for good sauce?
Well, because we wanted to actually rate the different establishments, it was important that we develop criteria that were consistent, right? And so some of the things we came up with would be pickle. So for instance, the pickle is what really distinguishes a sauce one place from another. So things we look for would be texture, flavor. If I had a spoonful of pickle by itself, would I enjoy it, right? And if pickle is like 70%, the meat itself should also be flavorful. It should be well cooked. It shouldn't be dry. It shouldn't be flaky, that kind of stuff, right? So heat, texture, flavor of the pickle. As far as the meat is concerned, how well it's cooked, and overall, when we're looking at things like pudding, you don't want it like that you can spread it on toast. You know, it has to have a consistency. You have to be able to tell it came from a sweet potato. Breadfruit, we've been places where people took breadfruits and they just put them in, I guess, like a pressure cooker or something. It was too hard to eat, right? So it should be mellow, it should be slightly sweet. So overall, you should have a good blend of flavors in your sauce.
Is portion important? The ratio of portion of sauce to the price of the sauce?
It's extremely important. And that's something else that we found as well. How much it varies. You can go someplace, $15, and you can still see the container. Other places you go, it's $10. And I mean, you can barely lift it, right? And so what we do is actually promote places where you find good portions. Actually, portion size is one of the criteria that we use.
How do you determine what establishment you're going to choose for your sauce expeditions? And I love that, the whole concept of a sauce expedition, where we are going to a particular place and we are going to eat sauce and we are going to talk about it.
It's word of mouth, basically. So in the group, people would go different places and they'd give feedback about sauce that they enjoy. And what I'm aiming to do is to actually have as objective a rating as possible. And that's what this expedition is about. So if we hear that it's good, we go a bunch of people having the same sauce at the same time, and then they submit feedback. So basically, it's just from sauce lovers to other sauce lovers, and that's where we go.
Ramon, you're known in the group as a sauce snob. So I take it that means that your criteria, your bar is set a little higher. Tell me about what you find so fascinating about sauce.
Well, I really, really enjoy the flavor. As Trevor was saying, it's a typical Bajan dish. And I guess I got that name, the sauce snob, because I've eaten sauce in many places, been on most of the sauce expeditions, and there have been a couple of places, not sauce expedition places, but there have been a few spots that I've been to, and just like you said, it was very subjective, you know, people swear by it, but then you get there and you're sorely disappointed. And if I don't like it, I don't eat it. I'll buy a $10, $15, $20, and if I don't like it, boom, garbage. It's just not worth it. You know, I'm not going to suffer through a bad meal. You know, so if the sauce is really, really good, I will preach it to the sauce expedition. I will preach it to the sauce members in the group. But if it's not up to scratch, I will say so. I mean, I will even take the opportunity to talk to the proprietor and say, well, this is where it can be better. I mean, I'm not an expert, but I do know a little bit about sauce.
Now, I know you to be a foodie and a great cook. So what are the particular things you look for in sauce?
I really, really enjoy well-cooked meat. You just can't boil it in water. It has to be lightly seasoned. If you take a piece of pork that you're going to put into a sauce, you should be able to eat it just as it is, and it should taste pretty okay, pretty good. When you add your pickle, now, it should have the right balance of heat, lime. You should taste a little bit of onion, parsley. Some people put celery. I really enjoy that. You know, so there's a lot of different things that change the dynamic of a good pickle, and that's the kind of stuff that I look for, and how it's prepared, how it's chipped. You know, some people like to put it through a fruit processor. That changes the flavors of everything.
The texture.
Dramatically, yeah. So but I like the old-time hand chip style. That's my thing.
What's the strangest sauce you've ever had?
Oh, I can't really say that I've ever had a strange one. That's the truth. You know, I mean, I've had pickled conch, pickled sea cat, you know, regular pickled pork, pickled chicken. But Fred's right now is doing a pickled fish, and I'm excited to try that.
When we return, I do a backflip through a flaming hula hoop. No? We're not doing that? Okay. All right. Well, stick around anyway.
So I gathered my sauce experts together for a night where we could discuss what really goes into making the best and worst sauce. Braff had been kind enough to invite us into his home where we were able to put together our very own pickle and sauce. Just to set the tone for the evening, it was a night filled with pork, good conversation, and of course, a little alcohol, because I mean, what evening wouldn't be complete without it?
I did have a sausage in George, and I found that the heat level was what I would determine to be mild.
Mm.
The majority of people felt that it was a little on the warm side, right? But yeah, the proprietress has a bowl of diced squash bonnet.
For you to adjust
for you to adjust the heat.
So if you're sorry,
and her sauce is actually very, very, very good. But I am one who does not believe in a post-mix sauce. You know, post-mix works with
the technical term.
A post-mix.
Do not assemble on arrival.
Really? Really? So this is something that I've found that I've seen so much more of. That is because people are asking for sauce that is not sauce. People are asking for pickled pig. Yes. Yeah. Yes. And pickled pig is not sauce.
So the whole idea is that...
Give this man a pulpit. So, the sauce factory many years ago, before it was all wall and everything, and Neville would come out with a tub full of sauce from the kitchen, right? And I serve it to you. What I found so intriguing about it was, one, it was some place called the sauce factory.
right? So you're cutting the bread from Mr. This and Mr. That. It's a sauce factory. I went there after, but I left Boosters Road. We left, we came out in a truck. I didn't know where it was going. Sun was coming up or whatever. But the sun was not up, so we got there just when it was starting about 11 o'clock. We sat down. And this sauce was hot, and it had a flavor profile I had never had before, right? So when I talk about a lot of chives specifically, it was amazing. And I always remember that. So as an experience, it was phenomenal. I wouldn't say it was necessarily the best sauce or pickle I ever had in retrospect, because I've had plenty. But in that moment, because it opened my mind, right? You know, the sauce is something you might have now and then. But here's this man who has a business named after sauce. This is what he does. And it is different from anything. I don't know if it's because it was even St. Michael's sauce. I don't know what the problem was. But it was different from what I had had before. And I will always remember that. I will always remember that as an experience.
Perfect idea.
Again.
I had a sauce there early one morning. You were there.
Yeah, we went.
And Scott came late.
It's true.
And that was one of the best
you had.
No, mind you, that day we went to three. It was three.
We went three two other places. Perfect was first. And we get slaughtered in beers.
Yeah. We went to some other sauce places.
The pudding was perfect.
I know.
It really doesn't matter which of the two. The consistency of the pudding itself. Mm-hmm. Is what I'm concerned about.
Yeah.
Whether it is steamed in a pan or it is inserted in the belly and then steamed, the pudding still has to have the right consistency. Yeah. You cannot get that consistency with a food processor.
No.
You cannot get
you
it.
No.
Right? It must be done on a grater and not just a regular grater you could go in the store and buy. It got to be one of graters that got the wood frame and the top in a little door and the holes punch in concentric circles.
We're busting signature.
You're right. Raging
And they got a grate. They got a grate in either a plastic basin,
right?
Or
and the skirt must be folded between the legs.
And they got a grate.
So I wanted to get the chance to go around Barbados and see a few choice spots known for their pickle. And for that, I took the Souse father along with me and we visited a few of the many, many spots across Barbados that sell pickle in tons of varieties. It was an expedition of Souse, or a mini Sousepedition, as Trevor would say.
The first stop on the Sousepedition was the Perfect Hideaway Bar, which definitely lived up to its name, as it's not easy to find, but the food was on point. Next, we headed back up into St. Michael to Nancy's Beer Corner, where we got some delicious Souse and amazing buljo. Traveled all through the scenic back roads of Barbados, all the way through Cliffland, St. John, to make our stop at the famous Souse Factory, where we sat down with Neville Wynn and had a couple drinks and ate some of their souse as he told us his story.
As you come to the Souse Factory in Cliffland, St. John,
yes,
and you met a big, ugly gray man. Which his name is Neville DaCosta Alfonso Carmichael Lynch.
Right.
They know a Souse man or a Souse flattery. Rough, man. Come up from a small guy, 7 years old, raising stocks and things.
Mm-hmm.
Cows and sheep and pig and the kitchen garden back, along with the old man.
Mm-hmm.
And I work out.
Okay.
They deliver customers every week. And the freezer get full of meat. Full of pickhead, really.
Mm.
I told the wife, I can make sauce Thursday or arrange a Thursday with St. Pickett's in the freezer. Instead of going to get away anything,
You can make sauce. Yes, sir. So I said, I can make a try. They make sauce on Wednesday. And some friends they had to speak easy. And the first time you never bought this ain't ready when it's ready, so they started sauce. They were selling sauce at $5. Small container. That's my one stress so. That was about 32 years ago.
Even my cameraman is eating pickle.
Yeah.
He's not eating sauce.
But he didn't say how it still tastes yet.
This is pickle.
This is pickle.
This is pickle.
So we left St. John and made our way down to Christchurch and through Oystons towards the Golden Sands Hotel, which had a line all the way to the door of people waiting for their sauce. Golden Sands has a karaoke and sauce line that really showcases how popular sauce is and how much money it really can make.
Every Saturday, we've been here for the last five or six years since they've started.
More than that,
because we were used to buy sauce from the other exit, but since they started the lime, I think the lime is only 5 or 6 years old. And we've been, I think it's six. Check with Jackie, but I think the lime is about 6 years old. And we've been here every Saturday since then, unless we are on the island.
What keeps you guys coming back?
It's just everybody very friendly, you know, and we just enjoy it. And usually we have a lot of people, but a lot of them are out of the island now. So, you know.
You were saying the crowd.
The karaoke. Occasionally I sing once in a blue moon, but they have so many good karaoke singers here. I just sit and listen to them most of the time. The amount of talent they have here is ridiculous.
People were there from all around and were definitely enjoying themselves. And we were able to try some of the sauce ourselves just to see what all the buzz was about. Now this was to be our final stop, but after leaving our cameraman James behind, we decided to head off to 8 Ball Bar and Restaurant, where we capped things off with a few beers and the famous pickled turkey wings.
And when we come back, I give little Becky that pony she always wanted. Who is writing these cue cards? Now, sauce is synonymous with pork, and if you look at the economics of sauce, you realize that sauce sells a lot in Barbados. And if sauce sells a lot in Barbados, that must mean that pork sales must be through the roof. So we talked to a butcher to find out what that is like. And we even got a chance to go to the cheap side market.
Yeah, my name is Greg Before. I'm a farmer. I sell meat as a vendor tool in cheap side market. Right now we carry about 400 or 500 pigs on the farm right now. But we kill meat the last at least 2 weeks.
So how many pigs do you tend to kill? Like on average?
Any given day, any Tuesday we kill anywhere about 70-80 pigs. Between 70-80, sometimes sheep, cows. Any different day we do here 4 days work. Close customers. But we got people at Friend Pork Chops too. It's a big thing. But most, not people scan for sales, mainly on between Pan of Fridays and Saturdays. It's a big business. Plus we layoffs. Some people get into it. Ain't got nothing else to do. Just getting on the sole business. And then we got some like 3 or 4 people saying one got doing sales and all selling. Some people ain't paying any attention, but it's $1 million industry in Barbados. Because certain areas may be small, for numbers that are small and animals can be.
So we took a further tour of Mr. Ford's pig farm to see the extensive amount of pigs he kept as well as the slaughtering area. Now, many Barbadians have come up seeing relatives or family friends slaughtering and killing pigs, but this was new for me, and it was not for the faint of heart, I will tell you. But Mr. Ford had a state-of-the-art and efficient setup. Took us down to the Cheapside Meat Market, where he sells his cuts of meat. It is a meat lover's dream, with various butchers displaying the finest cuts of local meat, from pork to beef to lamb to chicken.
Okay, that was good, but all of this still leaves one question unanswered. Where do we get the best sauce?
From Roslyn, yeah. I'll call him a Ross.
Perfect. See, sauce factory. Where your
best sauce money?
Sauce from Fred's Bar.
It seems as though this is all a matter of perspective, because some people still like their sauce with all lean, some people like it with more pepper, some like it with more lime. It's all a matter of subjectivity. It's all subjective. By the end of the day, it's all delicious.
So you're a sauce connoisseur as well?
I would like to think so, yes.
What do you like about sauce?
My thing is the pickle. I'm usually big on diced pickle. They're usually greater theirs, but that was not taken away from anything because I like a crunchy, nice, you know, firm pickle. But even though they're greater theirs, they still have good texture.
You know, everybody has a favorite, like, set of rules for their sauce, like particular set of meat that they're like, what's yours?
Oh, I like lean. Ears and feet. It's a weird mix. I don't like the tongue part. I know there's some guys here that really, really like the tongue. I'm not into tongue.
So you're not a pepper connoisseur either with it?
I like heat. I'm not like none. These other guys over here that can come and put extra pepper. But trust me, if you get a portion of pudding and souse from Fred's Bar, you're going to have a good set of heat in there without having to add anything extra. So if you are not big on pepper, don't add extra. Trust me.